I recently shot a video on genetics for dog and cat breeders, and I think this part is very important.
Why do you breed? What's your goal? What are you trying to achieve? What is your why here?
Define your why, and when you have it, use genetics to reach it. That's why I will be shooting a series of short videos on genetics and dog breeding. That's my project for the beginning of this year. And it starts now with the first chapter, Understanding the Laws of Heredity. Hello everyone, I'm Dr. He, and on this channel I share with you what I know on management of kennels and catteries. So if you're new here, consider subscribing. The thing is, genetics is a very complex science, and we often take as granted that everybody is familiar with its basic concepts. One thing I'm sure you are already aware of, genetics is all about definitions. There is a specific vocabulary, and I keep hearing people using it when they talk about this topic. But if you just got into dog breeding, or even if you've been breeding for a while, maybe you're not totally familiar with all those words. Selection in dog breeding is often based on appearance. This male plus this female, pretty sure it's going to give me nice puppies because both of them look really nice, right? That's what we call phenotypical selection. It is all about what we call the phenotype, which is this word you can see right here. Here is the definition of phenotype, the set of observable characteristics of an individual. And that's how every genetic selection program ever started, focusing on the phenotype. However, when you want to get deeper, when you really want to get to the heart of things, you need to focus on what we call the genotype. Genotype equals the genetic constitution of an individual. The genetic information this individual carries in all its cells, in his DNA. And as I already told you in a previous video, the DNA in mammals is carried by chromosomes. Trivia fact, dogs have 78 chromosomes per cell, which is a lot when we compare it to us humans, who only have 46 of them. Anyway, you can already see here an important concept emerging. The phenotype, as we described it, is indeed the expression of the genotype, and that's true in humans, dogs, cats. So why don't we only select on the phenotype? What you need to keep in mind, the phenotype is indeed the expression of the genotype, plus what we call the influence of the environment. Quick example, a woman has blonde hair. So from a genotype standpoint, she's blonde. But then she goes to the hairdresser and have them dyed in black. So now she has black hair. Phenotypically speaking, she has black hair. But from a genotype standpoint, she's blonde. You see where I'm going here, right? The exact same concept applies to our dogs. Let's say a dog is genetically programmed to weigh 30 kilograms, but it is overfed by its owner. By the way, number one nutritional mistake we see these days. And it ends up at 50 kilograms. The dog is overweight with all the consequences associated with this condition. But it's not his gene's fault. It's because the owner overfed it. Strong effect of the environment. Phenotypical selection is a start. But if you want to get serious in your breeding program, you need to look into the genotype. First thing you need to understand here, how is the genetic information transferred from the parents to the offspring? I just told you that dogs have 78 chromosomes. But something you need to keep in mind, chromosomes always come in pairs. Therefore, there are 39 pairs of chromosomes. In a dog, geneticists always write this down this way, 2n equals 78, n being the number of pairs of chromosomes in the dog. And why is that so important? Again, remember, genetic selection in canines often start with the evaluation of the phenotype of these individuals. That's why we often hear people saying, "Oh, this puppy looks so much like his father. This one must have passed more genetic information onto him." And that's wrong. This puppy might look more like his father. It has nothing to do with the transmission of genetic information. It has to do with something we call the law of dominance. You see, this is what we call a karyotype, a test we use from time to time to check if there is no extra chromosomes or chromosomes missing in the genome of our dogs. For repro specialists like me, This is a test we consider performing when we wonder if there is an intersex state in a dog, when what we used to call hermaphrodites or pseudo-hermaphrodites that could explain genital abnormalities or infertility cases. And look how those chromosomes are organized. They are all arranged in pairs. And in one pair, one chromosome comes from the individual's father and the other one from its mother. Always. So even if a puppy looks more like its father, it does not mean that this one passed more genetic info onto him. 50% of the puppy genetic info comes from its father and the other 50% from its mother. So I can hear you guys whispering now, even on YouTube. Great, but what's the point? How is this going to be able to help me in my genetic selection program? And believe me here, it will, because as soon as you understand how transmission of the genetic information works, then you are able to build something we call crossing tables. And that will help you better predict what you can obtain from the breeding. We are not there yet, however. Now let's focus on how genetic information is transmitted. And there are two essential cellular mechanisms that are involved here. The first one is what we call meiosis. You see, all the cells of our dogs have 78 chromosomes. And remember what geneticists say, 2n equals 78 in dogs. So if 2n equals 78 in a dog, and 50% of the genetic material comes from the father and the other 50% comes from the mother, the father and the mother must pass n equal 39 chromosomes to their offsprings. Basic math, right? Their genetic material must be split in half, and that's what meiosis does. In the gonads, the testes in the males, the ovaries in the females, those organs that are producing the gametes, the spermatozoa and the egg. One spermatozoa will carry n equal 39 chromosomes. One spermatozoa will only have one chromosome of each pair, and the same goes for the egg. After breeding, the sperm cell and the egg will merge during what we call fecundation, and chromosomes will be back in pairs. Let me explain here with an example. Let's take something with just three pairs of chromosomes. Three pairs of chromosomes that are going to be separated in half during meiosis. That's what we call segregation of the homologous chromosomes. So you see, if this was a male, the chromosomes could split like this during meiosis. But that is just one possibility. They could also split like this. Or like this. Or even like this. You see, it is a totally random phenomenon. We started with three pairs of chromosomes. That gives us eight genetically different spermatozoa, eight different possibilities. And as we said, the same goes for the egg. So again, basic math. Three pairs of chromosomes, eight different potential spermatozoa, eight different potential eggs. And remember what I said. The spermatozoa and the egg will merge at the time of fecundation, and chromosomes will be back in pairs. So again, if we do some math here, three pairs of chromosomes means eight different potential spermatozoa, eight different potential eggs. That leads us to 64 potential different embryos, with only three pairs of chromosomes being considered. And remember what we said about our dogs? They have 39 pairs of chromosomes. 39 pairs of chromosomes means you can obtain 2 to the power of 39 different sperm cells. Same for the eggs. One breeding can therefore theoretically produce 2 to the power of 78 embryos, basically more than 550 billion genetic possibilities. And those here are your potential puppies. Now you might wonder, what's the point of focusing on the genotype when basically you have more chances to win the national lottery instead of finding or getting the right genetic mix you are interested in? And that's one important fact. Today, you cannot fully predict the entire genotype of your puppies. There's always a part of uncertainty. And that's what biology is all about. That being said, after watching this short video, you now understand how chromosomes are segregated. And when you consider one trait of interest, one interesting gene, then based on that, you can build those crossing tables we mentioned before. And now you can try to predict the genotype of your puppies for this specific characteristic. You wonder how to do this? Well, I'll definitely encourage you to hit this subscribe button then, because that's what we will discuss in our next video. Thank you guys for watching. If you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up and share it with your friends. More videos to come on this topic, but meanwhile, I have a question for you guys. Tell me, what is your why? What are you trying to achieve with your breeding program? Let me know in the comment section below. Take care, guys. I'll see you very soon in another video.